we had so much fun with last week, where we talked at length about the bylaws. We sent information out to our members. I think it was 2 weeks ago with details. And now I will ask Yvonne Elkin.
Okay. All right. So hopefully you all read your newsletter and were able to look through the final proposed version of the bylaws. I'd like to start off first by thanking my committee, Rosamond Blevins, Nicole Crosby, Ruth Rollins, and Jen French, as well as all the help we got from Susan and Kathy and Luana and everybody else. It took us now, we are at 3.5 months that we've been working on this, and it'll be great to get it, you know, get moved beyond it. So it is on the agenda as a consent item. So we are gonna just quickly review what changes we made and show you what we did. Hopefully I can share my screen. Except I don't know how to do this. Oh, there it is, okay. So I don't know. So I did that. Oh, I hit share. Yay, can you all see it?
Uh-huh,
yes.
All right, cool. So what I'm gonna do is just quickly highlight the things that we decided to make changes on at our meeting last week. And then I am going to entertain a motion for unanimous consent. So in that first paragraph highlighted in yellow, we changed a word, and I don't remember what the word was, but we changed it to developing. Then in the section one eligibility, we basically moved it back to what our original bylaws said in that first paragraph. And then we added this section about non-Democrats who are registered to vote other than Republicans and want to affiliate with the Democratic Women's Club San Diego will become associates. And associates don't count towards a quorum or can't vote and all of that sort of thing. So then moving on to eligibility for voting. I just want to talk about that a minute. And you see, I highlighted that in blue rather than yellow. So after our meeting, we had originally said, as of at the end of the meeting last month, that all general members in good standing who have attended at least 3 prior meetings in the previous 12 months shall be eligible to vote. So when we got off the meeting sometime during that week, Rosamond went through the membership list to determine who would be eligible to vote. And we quickly learned that if we required 3 or even 2 meetings, we would disenfranchise over 50% of our members. So we really didn't want to do that, but we still wanted to keep protections so that we are protected against what they call club packing, which is getting a lot of brand new members who want to support an endorsement. So this is the language that we decided to put in there. We said any member who has paid their dues by the beginning of a general meeting and has been verified by an executive office shall be eligible to vote on club matters during general meetings, except those listed below. And then in that second paragraph, it says a member of good standing who has attended at least 1 prior meeting in the previous 12 months and for new members has paid their dues at least 45 days prior to the meeting date shall be eligible to cast their vote for club officers elections and club endorsements. So that strikes a balance, we think, between encouraging people to participate as quickly as they join with us, but also protecting us when we're electing our officers and doing endorsements. So moving on, we just added a phrase in the elected officers section saying, should any elected member of the executive board, and it meant elected member of the executive board and not appointed member is basically what that one does. And then one more down towards the end, we actually made a change that said that the nominating committee shall consist of 3 people and that they will be elected rather than appointed. So those are the only changes from what we submitted to you at our meeting in January. So, I'm sorry. I forgot one more. Okay, so this also talked about, this section was talking about people representing the club in various other Democratic Party organizations. And we just kind of clarified that one to say they should be appointed by a vote of members in good standing at the October meeting in odd number of years. All right, so that does it. That's all of them. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to invite a motion to pass this by acclamation.
I make that motion.
I have the motion. Do we have a second?
Who was the name of the name of the motion maker, please?
Dave Myers.
I seconded.
Thank you.
All right, so so we could, if you unmute yourselves, we could do it, but you must have a V or a V1 in front of your name to vote.
So Shane, if you have a question. Shane has a question.
Okay, wait a minute, I can't see because my screen is, how do I unshare?
Stop sharing.
All right, let me see if I can do this. And there's somebody in the thing.
Do you want me to just unmute and talk? You don't have to stop sharing your screen.
Okay, go ahead.
Does that work? I mean,
that's fine, but I still need this so I can see other things anyway.
Got it. And usually after you have the motion and the second, then the person who made the motion has the opportunity to speak to it, and then you have debate before you take a vote, just as an FYI. I had a question because I didn't quite get to see the language and I wasn't sure if I heard it correctly. Did you say you're changing the requirement from having to have attended two meetings in the last year to just one?
Well, actually, and we left it on at the last meeting at three meetings. That's what we had agreed on. That was the motion that finally was settled on. And yes, we changed it to one. And that was because even if we asked them to attend two meetings, right now, that disenfranchises over 50% of our membership.
So can I make a suggestion for amendment, if it's friendly or not, we can figure that out. I think the goal you're saying is, if people forgot to pay their dues, you still want them to be able to pay their dues and participate in voting.
Actually, Shane, wasn't the problem.
Right?
It was also related to attendance.
The problem really was that it centers around election of officers and endorsements. So that's why, if you can see, can you see the screen now? I have it up.
Yeah.
That's why the second paragraph requires that they return, you know, that they attend at least one meeting. And if they have if they are a new member, have paid their dues at least 45 days prior to the endorsement or election of officers meeting.
So I thought the original point, and several clubs are doing this, the point of raising it to three was so that you still don't have people doing that, like that you don't just pay your dues and show up once a year and then show up again to vote because you're really only interested in the club and voting. And so that in the last year with Zoom, I mean, people have had the opportunity to come to the club meeting, and that's why we were raising it to three.
Again, it concerned us in our discussions.
Because people haven't been coming to the-
How many people would be disenfranchised?
So I guess then it's, so they haven't been coming to the club meetings, but then they're gonna show up to vote. And that was the point of raising it to three. Is so that we don't just have people who pay their dues and only do it to show up to vote for endorsements.
Right. I hear what you're saying.
Yeah. So
I
don't support lowering it to one.
Okay.
Because that's literally the point. Now it seems like we're lowering it exactly for the reason we said we wanted to raise it, to prevent people who do not come to this club to suddenly be able to show up because now there's suddenly going to be an endorsement vote.
Okay. So do you want to make a do you want to make an amendment to the motion to acclamation and give and provide new language?
I move a substitute motion that we include all of the changes except for changing it to the one meeting requirement.
And what would you change it? What would you want it to say?
That we leave it at the three that we had agreed to last time.
All right, do I have a second on that?
Sarah Davis, second. I'll second that.
Michelle.
Michelle, you're seconding?
Yes.
Okay. All right, discussion on that? Other than, you know, Shane, I assume we've heard your pro on that.
Yeah, correct. Like that's, I mean, and I just to like, the point is we didn't want club stacking. And so now I don't think we should change it because suddenly there's going to be an endorsement and people who haven't been showing up for meetings want to vote. It literally proves the point and the necessity to raising it to the three meeting. And that's it.
Right. I have a lot of people who have raised their hands.
So I think Shane has been heard and we do have a lot of people if we can.
Right. And so each of you, why don't I do this first? I would like to take three comments in favor of the changes that that Shane is proposing first. So if you are raising your hand to support the change to three meetings, leave it up. If you are raising your hand to oppose that, would you please put it down until I call on you?
So how about if I lower all hands and then the people who are going in favor raise their hand?
Okay, so Rose, I see you're in favor.
Yes, but I do, it's.
Could you, just a minute, just take one minute, please.
Sure.
So are you gonna speak to that?
Yes, I'm in favor, but I would like to say effective at some date, so that it gives people a chance to catch up with the changes.
Well, this is, I mean, so tonight is election of officers and we're done with that for a year.
Oh, I see.
All meetings and all votes. This restriction only applies to officer elections and endorsement elections.
Okay.
So general club meetings where we vote on a motion, everybody can vote on that.
Okay, I'm fine.
So you're still, okay.
Yes, I'm still in favor.
Okay, all right, can you lower your hand and let me do Francine, are you raising your hand in favor of this?
Yes, I'm in favor of the three. I just wanted to know if I can get some clarity on where the disenfranchisement comes from, because people get disenfranchised when their room is packed and they're only there for the endorsement and then it's crickets when we want to get real things done. So if you could just, someone can share that, where you wanted to lower it to one with the disenfranchisement piece, if somebody could just share that with me.
It just meant that less than 50% of our members would be eligible. That's what we call disenfranchisement. All right, Dave, are you you're in favor of raising it to three as well?
So I don't know if this would make it easier, but as the maker of the motion, I'm willing to accept as part of my motion what Shane's subsequent motion was. So if you want to just incorporate that, and if the second of the motion would accept it, then we could just go on to general discussion and we won't have to have two votes.
Okay. I don't know. So somebody tell me who's a parliamentarian, whether that
motion is made, it doesn't belong to the maker anymore. It belongs to the floor, to the body. So I don't think you can amend it. Is that correct, Doug? I'm pretty sure, Shane. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. We now have two separate motions and they have to be voted on separately.
It was a substitute. Sorry, did you want me to explain?
Yeah.
This is Shane. So, right. So a substitute motion is in order. And so what happens is people can debate it. And honestly, if no one's arguing against it, then it sounds like consensus has been reached. And then what people make the mistake of is they say, I move to close debate, but there's still two motions on the floor.
Right.
So what you want to say is I move to close debate on all motions before the floor. And if there's no objection to that, boom. And then you can go to a vote.
All right.
Otherwise, if you just close debate.
Yeah, so Shane, we haven't even gotten to the people asking for people opposed. So right. We don't know that's how many just people are opposed yet.
Okay.
All right, so it is still two motions. It's a and we'll have to vote on Shane's and then go back to Dave's. Okay, so we've had three. So I'll just take Rebecca and then we're gonna go on to opposed. So Becca?
Oh, I am actually, I'm opposed, so we're—
All right, let me just verify if anybody else—
I'm for it.
Yeah, and I know you've already seconded it. So you wanna—
Right, you asked for three people to speak, that's why I said—
Okay, all right, well, okay, so we'll take you, Michelle, and then we'll move on to the opposed.
Yeah, just this has been a real problem within the party of how people are figuring out the loopholes. And so I do agree with making it at least some hurdle of authenticity. People can still go around it as they need to, but I mean, not as they need to, as they will try to. But I don't want to make it that easy as it is. People show up for 2 minutes for the vote and then they say that they were in attendance at the meeting. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, so let's move on to people who are opposing the motion. So Becca?
Yeah, I have so much respect for Michelle Krug and her sort of knowledge of all the obstacles here, and I get it, and Shane too, but I wanted to share with you all of the things that I am doing while this meeting is happening and like why some people might not be going to all these meetings. So right now I'm cooking dinner, my kid is taking a bath, and in like the time when I was trying to pay attention to this meeting, she like somehow got into a bottle of lotion. So we have kind of struggled to have younger people and parents in this club. And the reason we often don't come is because it's dinner time on a Monday. It doesn't mean we're not committed. It just means there's a lot going on.
Okay. All right, thank you. Sarah, are you opposed as well?
I support.
Okay, so Sarah, then I think Andrea, so Sarah, we've already got all the support we need. So we're going to move on. We're just doing opposed right now. Okay, so we had Becca. Andrea?
Yeah, actually, sorry, I got the phone and the iPad mixed up. So okay. This is Beatrice, yes. Sorry.
I'm
the IT person here, obviously. So I guess I'm opposed. I would prefer something more like two meetings, because I'm very much with Rebecca that life is really crazy and it's very difficult for people to attend, some people to attend two meetings. I know that you can attend remotely, but what are you going to do if someone says, well, there were so many people in the Zoom meeting, I couldn't get on, but I watched the Zoom video. I attended by Zoom, but not Zoom video. I attended by watching the YouTube video. How are you going to keep count of people that are attending, okay, but exceed the numbers that show up for the Zoom meeting?
Okay,
all right. So to me, there's some issues in terms of numbers. You can pack 200 people into a meeting before, in the 3 months before endorsements, but you can't do that in a Zoom meeting, I don't think.
Yes, you can.
You can?
Yeah, I think the premium.
If you get a better subscription.
Right, and we do have that.
So I think one's not enough. I think three is a little bit difficult. I think two is a good compromise.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Beatrice. Rob?
Yeah, I needed clarification. I think we were talking about, my understanding of the club stacking thing was people would pay and do it. But it sounds like people can be in good standing financially and then be asked to do the three meetings. And yes, the challenge for me is, I know we're thinking about, when I look at bylaws, I look long-term. And so I'm just wondering, how is this gonna be when we get to where we're actually going to the meetings? Are we gonna actually continue doing them online For people who have, you know, an hour drive or on the northernmost part of the county. I mean, so that's my concern is just, I'm not against it. I think there should be hurdles, but I don't know what the right point is. So the being financial, I guess my question is, it's not about them paying their dues. It's about whether or not they're coming to the meetings.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. All right, so we have, first place, I just really.
Point of order.
Yes, Ruth.
Is it possible that we vote on the part that we agree on and set this particular section aside and ask everybody to send in their comments and then work on it next month? As you said, it's not critical because today is the last election we'll have.
Right, but it will matter on today's election.
Yvonne?
Yes, ma'am.
There's a couple of problems with this. First of all, if we go with the three at this point, it's going to take me probably 45 minutes to find out who has attended those three and go through that list again. So we'll have to credential those people again. One of the things I wanted to say, the reasons I'm against it is this. Some of our members weren't familiar with Zoom. Zoom was scary for them at the beginning. Now we're all familiar with it. So they didn't, at the beginning, maybe attend all that many meetings. Second, we put a provision in there for the 45 days. So that, again, makes it seem that you have to be a paid member for 45 days. You can't join just before the endorsement. You have to be a member 45 days and attend one meeting before you can vote for officers or endorsements. So I think that alone would help in weeding out anybody else that's coming in there just for the endorsements. So if we vote on that today and we vote for the three, it's going to take me a little while to find the members that are qualified to vote. Right. And again, we will, again, less than 50%, 37% of our members will be eligible to vote for officers at this meeting today.
Right, thank you. Kathy?
Yeah, just as one of the people who's been working on the bylaws for all these weeks and months, one of the other things is, are you going to tell somebody who wants to join the club they have to wait 3 months before they can vote on an endorsement? I mean, I think that's really, that's going to be something that's going to discourage members from signing up. It's like, well, you can join tonight, but you can't vote on any of the endorsements that we have for the next 3 months.
Just a point of clarification.
Point of order. Haven't we closed our three in support?
Yeah, I think so. I think we're ready to take a vote.
Well, I was just speaking as those of us that worked on the bylaws behind the scenes, that we've already had all of these discussions and this is what we brought to the table. And we did email out the bylaws for everybody to review in advance and to submit their comments. And then now we're hearing this feedback. So it's a little discouraging for us as well, because we know it's a compromise. We understand that.
A point of order. It wouldn't be 3 months. It would be 2 months because they would have been there at that meeting, which would have counted. Then they would have had to attend two more meetings. And on that third meeting, they would be able to vote.
All right. So how about we do this? Let's take it to the vote for Shane's amendment. So the amendment is that, and let me see if I can just, that to vote for an officer or an endorsement, a member in good standing who has attended at least three prior meetings in previous 12 months, and for new members has paid at least 45 days prior to the meeting, shall be eligible to vote for club officer elections and club endorsements. So that's the the seconded motion that is before us right now. And so let's, so what I'd like you to do is, if you are in favor, please, okay, in favor of Shane's motion, please vote yes now.
I don't see a way to vote, so my answer.
Oh, okay, all right. So, in fact, you could, if you're not in favor, please vote no. So we could just get this over in one vote. So if you're in favor, say yes. If you're not in favor, say no.
Yes. Point of order. On the what? Zoom updated a few weeks ago, and some people's yes and no buttons, they click them and it lasts for like 7 seconds and then it fades. That's right. So that's we've been right. Moving to hands up and hands. We've been doing the hands because those don't fade. The raise hands.
Shane's correct.
I was wondering why the numbers were going up and down as I was trying to count. Thank you, Shane.
It's a nightmare for teachers.
So what do we have to do?
Raise your hand for yes, and then.
Okay, we'll so do we have to? Okay, but some of us who are hosts and co-hosts can't raise our hands.
So the people that are host or co-host, can you DM Yvonne?
Or just raise your hand in the.
Just raise your hand in the window.
Like I did.
Okay.
So if you're cat like, okay. So we're voting yes. So that's, I want the yeses now since we're voting, we're raising our hands. All right. So if, is there, Ruth, you're voting yes?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't have anything on the screen that allows me to vote.
Okay. If you see the more, you can click more and it'll give you raise your hand.
Option. All I have is invite or mute me.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Let me.
Oh, I see Lori has her hand up.
But that's, we're voting yes. I mean, yes. Those are people that are voting yes. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And does anybody have their, is somebody else watching? Do we have other people that have their hand up in the screen? Not you, Kathy. Oh. Kathy, you're not raising your hand, are you?
Yvonne, do you see Lori Seldon?
Yeah. Where? I don't, okay. Okay, where? I don't see Lori.
Lori, are you voting yes?
She is raising her hand.
Well, but so are a lot of other people raising their hand.
So right, so she's the person who's physically raising her hand.
Oh, in the raised okay, hand, so but isn't. She is not online here?
Correct. No, she's raising her hand, yes, but she doesn't have her icon raised, her little hand symbol raised.
She's saying yes. She's voting for it.
Okay, so is that the only other person then? So we have, let me count again.
13. 12 plus 1 is 13.
We have exactly 33 members that are eligible. And I have,
so Lori's hand is now up in the participants tab. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I somebody want to double check with me, but I counted 12.
Yes, it's 12 in the participants tab.
Yes.
Did okay, you,
plus,
Yvonne,
plus Michelle.
Yvonne, did you get my DM for Dave and Dom?
No, because I can't. Is somebody else, so you did that in the chat?
Yes, directly to you.
Okay, yeah. I'm looking. Okay, so you both are yes, so that's 14?
15. Michelle's a yes also.
15, okay, so we have 15 yeses. Vaughan, all right, sorry. So please put your hands down. Everybody, please remove your, put your hands down.
Yvonne?
Yes, ma'am.
Dom is telling me that Michelle had her hand raised.
I counted Michelle.
Okay.
No, on the tab, you counted her twice.
Oh, you counted her twice.
Oh, okay, then we have, then we have 14. All right, so all of you who had your hand raised, please put it down now. And we are taking votes for those who are opposed. So now raise your hand if you're opposed to extending this to 3 months. Getting creative to motivate people to get the COVID vaccine. The unique incentive is offering San Diego's okay, let me go back up here. Why don't I see this? All right, so I can't raise, so I'm raising my hand, and Susan, you're raising your hand?
I'm raising my hand also, it's Rosemond.
Three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So it's 15 to 14. So 15 are opposed.
I caught 14. Do you want to try that?
Did
one?
You count Susan, Susan's Kathy? Hand
raised. Susan is in the participants tab with a hand raised.
Isn't it? I thought that was John.
John is also, and Kathy is also.
Okay, well then let me go back. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, I hate this because it bounces around on me every time I move. So Susan is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, it's 14 to 14.
What about John?
John is here and he already raised his hand.
Yeah. Great. So motion fails, Yvonne, if it's a tie.
Okay, thank you.
To pass.
So this,
all right, so now we are back to...
This is Sarah Davis. I'd like to make a motion to do the same thing Shane just said, but 2 instead of 3.
Shane Parmley, I second.
Okay, so that's an... Good. So do we need... So is there any discussion that we have to have? And everybody please to put your hands down in the thing so we can get that done. So... Anything new to discuss? Because if we don't have to go back and rediscuss it, that would be great.
I would like to, as the maker of the motion, just say that I think that I can bring in more members with this being less of an endorsement circus, and the room packing really turns off people who are outside of these really tight circles. I'm really looking forward to bringing people into the club, and I support anything we can do to prevent the stacking and packing and whatever we call it.
All right. Anybody want to quickly, I'll take one person who wants to maybe oppose. Doug, is that you?
No, I was going to speak in favor. I think it's a reasonable compromise.
Okay. All right, anybody else have anything else they want to add to this before we take a vote on this one? All right, so now the vote is, and it's amended, but again, on the amendment, that was raised by Sarah and seconded by Shane, that we change the language and require people to attend two meetings, two prior meetings in the last 12 months and have paid their dues 45 days in advance of the meeting to vote for officer elections and endorsements. So if you
can, I make a suggestion.
Yes,
that we make it effective after this meeting, so we don't have to do the calculation because we're only voting on the opposite.
You know, that would be awesome.
Yes, that would be great.
Yeah. Also, Andrea and Beatrice both have their hands raised.
This is Sarah. If I'm able to add what Doug just said to the motion, then I'm happy to add that.
You can do it by unanimous consent. So if nobody objects, you can make it effective after the meeting.
So we have one person that has their hand raised.
So Beatrice, do you want to talk? No. Okay. There we go.
No, I was just getting ready to do the vote.
Okay. So
trying to move us along. Sorry.
Here's where I think we're at.
Please.
Shane, do you second the change?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So where we are at, that we're going to amend the proposed bylaws to say that in order to vote on elections and endorsements, you must have attended two meetings in the prior 12 months and paid your dues 45 days in advance, and that this particular amendment will not be effective until the end of this meeting. So, all of those who are in favor of this amendment, please raise your hand in the different tab. What?
Nothing. I thought I got disconnected. I don't know if it showed or not.
Oh, okay. I'll give you just like one more minute. So Michelle, okay, I see you now. Okay, Michelle.
Thank you.
Dave and Dominic times two.
Okay. People are still voting. Anybody else who hasn't voted that still wants to vote, please do that now.
20, 21,
22. Okay, and then I'm going to vote yes on this one. So, all right, so 1, 2, 25.
So if it's 25 in total, Yvonne.
Yeah, it's
20. And plus me.
Plus Dominic.
Including you and Dominic.
And Dominic, okay.
And Rosamund.
Rosamund, are you voting yes on this too? Where is Rosamund?
Rosamund had raised her hand.
Okay. How does everybody get to raise their hand and I can't?
No, she raised her actual hand.
Oh, okay. So John, you had 25 including Rosamund too?
26 with Rosamund.
All right. 26, 4, and then please take your hands down. All right, anybody opposed?
So, Michelle, are you voting for opposed or are you just having a problem?
No, I thought I took it down. Thank you for noticing.
No.
Is it down now?
No.
It's down now.
Thank you.
Okay, so right now I see only one. Okay, so one opposed. So that motion carries. Now somebody walk me through, what do I have to do to get back to that first motion?
So now
I move to close debate on all but motions before the floor.
Second.
And we have a second on that. So we've closed debate. Now, but again, do I have to take a vote now on that first one?
Yes.
And what is that now? I mean, it was to accept it as is, so now it's not. It's now been amended to
so
be
it's to accept as is with the exception of the amendment.
So it's
okay,
and that's usually why you close debate on all motions before the floor at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So we are now
order. Point of order. I believe if you move to close debate, you have to vote on that before you move on.
Because that's a motion.
Or you can say without objection. You can say without objection, we'll close debate. Is there objection? Somebody can object and then you have to vote.
Yeah, or you can say, shall the substitute motion become the main motion and just have one vote.
Okay, so we have the original motion was, we've got a motion to close debate. So does that mean I have to say, does anybody have an objection on that?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm asking if anybody has an objection. No objections. So now we go back and the motion, the original motion was to accept the bylaws by acclamation, but now it is with including the changed language on the eligibility for voting, which now reads, and I will read this again for everybody. It's a member in good standing who has attended at least two prior meetings in the previous 12 months, and for new members has paid their dues at least 45 days prior to the meeting, shall be eligible to vote for club officer elections and club endorsements. And that change is not to take effect until the end of this meeting. So, now I guess we can vote by voice vote on this because it's by consent or acclamation. So if you'll take yourself off mute, all in favor of accepting the bylaws with the changes decided tonight, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say nay. Oh, passed. Thank you. All right, it's yours, Luana.
Yay. That wasn't too painful. It's only 7:20. Let's give everybody a big hand for that one. So now, to break up the voting, I thought this would be a good time to switch over to a couple of Black History Month presentations. And I'm gonna start with Carol Jeffries. Carol Jeffries is the current president of A. Philip Randolph Institute in San Diego. She's a graduate from the National Labor College with a Bachelor of Arts degree in Business Administration. She also worked and retired early as an analyst with the California Department of Transportation, having served the state for 34 years. She's held the position as president of SEIO Local 1000, District 701 in San Diego, where she was diligent in learning and dealing with community issues and political action campaigns, such as the Fight for $15 and a Union Retirement Security for All, political engagement of the underserved community, such as Get Out the Vote, and holding elected positions as an assembly district delegate for District 79. She's also a small business owner who believes in building generational wealth. As a rental property owner believes in building strong communities and supporting families, it is important to take care of our communities and educate our community members. I'll make the rest of her bio available for people that want to read it. And Carol, thank you so very much for being here, and I'm looking forward to what you have to share.
Okay, hello everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. And first off, I'd like to share a little bit about A. Philip Randolph Institute and how it was established. It was established in 1965 by Asa Philip Randolph and Bernard Rustin. Randolph was born in 1889 and he died in 1979. And Rustin was born in 1912. And he died in 1987. But the vision for good jobs and strong families still moves forward. A. Philip Randolph organized and led the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters. And it was the first predominantly African-American labor union. My grandfather was a sleeping car porter. Randolph and Rustin also organized the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. So this is consistent throughout history, always looking for jobs, freedom, and trying to make family lives better. They recognize that Black and working people of all colors share the same goals, political, social, and economic justice and freedom. APRI is a senior constituency group from the AFL-CIO. We work for people and better communities. We work for racial equality, economic and political justice. The national APRI president is Cleola Brown, and we are in 31 states. The Western regional director is James Bryant, and he is out of San Francisco. The San Diego chapter of APRI was established here in San Diego in 2015. And there were 9 different unions that came on board and more after that. So we've been here for 6 years and we're still trying to move forward. We're asking like-minded people who believe in God, strong families, and education to join us and help build a strong organization to empower people working for strong communities and families. I became president in 2020. And we're working on creating a virtual presence. Because of COVID, that is just the way that everything is moving forward. And so if we still want to have an impact, we have to get on board. So I applaud you guys for having a lot of things done. It looks like you're moving forward and getting people used to Zoom and getting people used to still interacting that way, which is very nice. So now let me share a little story with you. This story is about Eleanor Eldridge, and I find her story very inspirational and a tribute to the strength of our ancestors. Eleanor Eldridge was born on March 26th. The documents say either 1784 or 1785. Her mother was a Native American, Hannah Prophet, and her mother bore 9 children. Her father was Robin Eldridge, a survivor of the Revolutionary War and a free man. Eleanor came from a family that was economically stable, respected in the community. Her family owned land in Warwick, Rhode Island. After the death of her mother, Eleanor developed skills in various jobs, everything from laundress, spinner, weaver, making soap, making paper, and other things as well. But her greatest skill was developing the skills of a businesswoman. She saved her money, she owned property, and she understood common decency, morality, and contracts. Eleanor dealt with a corrupt sheriff and business people who tried to take her property. She had worked for years and built a home and a business, and she loved what she had done. So when they came after her and tried to take everything that she had built over a lifetime, it was friends who united with her. And it was women's rights movement and a best-selling book titled Memoirs of Eleanor Eldridge that told the story of a wronged property owner seeking justice. She was able to keep her property through fundraising and a platform that moved the public to request justice. The story is important because political clubs have the same ability to empower communities and make people's lives better. So I just hope that you all continue with the work that you're doing and just always try and keep the respect and dignity and the option of building better communities. Thank you.
All right, so that was my, I won't say it was my first mistake, but probably the one obvious to unmute. Our next speaker is, first, thank you, Carol. I said a lot, but I was muted, so you didn't get to hear me clap and tell you how much I appreciated you sharing that story and just taking the time to be with us. And we hope that you'll consider being a more frequent visitor and maybe becoming a member of our club.
All right, thank you.
So our next speaker is Dr. Helen Griffith, who was appointed the inaugural executive director of the Preuss School at UC San Diego in 2019. And since then, I've watched her dynamism impact everything from donors to, of course, students and student outcomes in a positive way. And when I spoke with her, she said she would be happy to come and talk to us about some local Black history. So Dr. Griffiths, are you ready to share with our members?
Yes, good evening. And I have 3 minutes. What time do you end tonight? You end at 7:30?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No, well, don't end at 7:30. You have more than 3 minutes.
Okay.
I was just trying to give you some, get you to block off some time because I know how busy you are.
Oh, there you go. I didn't want to go over time. I really like being timely. So thank you for having me tonight. It's been an honor to sit and see the business of the evening. It's always awesome to see women. And of course, there's some men on the line, but I couldn't see many of you. But it's always awesome to see women handling the business. And I am proud to be here tonight as a partner with you in the work, as a partner with you to make transformation, as a partner with you to leave San Diego, our state, our nation, and our world better than we found it. So it's good to be here tonight. I am technically not a native of San Diego, but I've been here as long as I can remember. When I woke up, I was in San Diego. I just want to share with you a little bit about what you may not hear in the history books, but that it's really pretty typical of most every family. And that's the story of personal activism, collective activism, and unity in getting a common goal done. My family is from the deep south of Mississippi, which hails as one of the most violent states that did many atrocities to people of color, to Black people. And my family prevailed from the state of Mississippi. And I stand on the shoulders of some very strong Black women who were in the work and who told the story of the work throughout my generation, of course, to my children and now to my children's children. And I just want to share just a little bit about our story tonight from the great state of Mississippi, where I was actually born, in a small town called Newton, Mississippi. But who preceded me? There were several who preceded me, but I spent a lot of time with my grandmother, Catherine Whitfield, who was born at the turn of the century in 1901. And she tells us a story, several stories, of course, about how they had to persevere and overcome segregation, racism, so many atrocities that were in the family, even to the point where it was illegal for them to learn to read and to write when my grandmother was growing up. But there were white allies who would come alongside of our family and to teach them to read and to write, because they knew and they believed that education was a way out. Education was not only a way out for people of color, but it was a way to elevate the entire community. And as I hear my grandmother's story about them, of course, sitting at home one night and the night riders coming to and took her brother away, who they never saw again after he was 9 years old. And of course, all of the segregation in terms of schools and they not being able to, of course, go to the equal schools of their counterparts in the state of Mississippi, but yet they triumphed and they persevered. And they believed that, of course, they had to have personal activism and collective activism so that they could make a better life for not only for them, but for others to come behind them. And then later I recall a story of my aunt, Yvonne Whitfield, who was born in 1920. And she was born in the state of Mississippi as well. And she, at the time when my grandparents and my aunts were born and my mother was born, it wasn't socially acceptable for Black people to protest, especially in the state of Mississippi. It was an immediate sentence for hanging or lynching or a cross being burned on your lawn. And so they had to activate their protests in ways that were not detected. So that meant that they helped each other get ahead by helping them learn to read and write, helping them to master skills where they could earn a living, helping them to present themselves in a way that they could then create a better life, which was what their way of activism, until they got to the point where their voice could actually be heard one day without the fear, of course, being lynched or killed or murdered. And so I recall the story of my Aunt Joy, Marceline Joy Whitfield, who attended the school there in Newton, Mississippi. And now she's born in 1927, so we're moving on up in the world now where we can kind of have a voice. And my aunt shared a story with me about in the 12th grade, when her classmates got together in unity to protest against the inequities that they had in their schools, where they had a dirt floor. They didn't have books that were bound. They had books that were passed me down and hand me down and books that were coming apart. And they had inadequate facilities, yet they persevered in education. But they got together in the 12th grade and they said, we're gonna protest against these inequities. And when they stood to do the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all white people, they said it together. The teacher stopped and said, that is not appropriate. I need you to say it in the correct way. They repeated, with liberty and justice for all white people. The teacher said, if you do it again, I'm gonna give you all an F, and they're seniors. They said, with liberty and justice for all white people. And she gave each of those students an F. And my aunt carried that F, that one F, because she was a straight A student. She carried that one F to the historically Black college, Dillard University, where she entered school the next year and had to explain why she had this F on her transcript. While they didn't know the impact of their unity and their collective activism, they didn't see it right away. They knew they were standing up, because they had to make a difference. They had to let their voice be heard to make a difference for those in the state of Mississippi and many other states to come for the people of color. My aunt graduated from Dillard University in New Orleans, returned back to Mississippi as a nurse to get a job in the hospital, only to have her paycheck be cashed if a white woman signed it with her. She found an ally to sign that check with her so she could receive her pay. But then the ally together then raised her voice to try to change the policies of that city so that people of color could have their own check written and stand on their own education and be equal and equal citizens in the city of Newton in the state of Mississippi. Because they united together over a cause and they were collectively becoming activists. And by this time, you could speak out a bit in terms of the injustices and the inequities and the racism, but not too much, because it was this was still around 1945, 55, when this was happening. And my mother comes along and goes away to her school, Tougaloo College, another historically Black college, because in that day, people of color could not enter the institutions that we can now enter, University of California, San Diego, or San Diego State, or any other institution. They had to go to these institutions where they could get an education with people who look like them. My mother entered Tougaloo College in the 50s, and she began to become active and become involved in creating a better life for people of color. Her institution was very diverse and one of the first diverse historically Black colleges in Tougaloo, Mississippi. And because of that, they had a mark on them where they couldn't go out alone. They told them to go out in twos because they were creating, they were dismantling segregation in the state of Mississippi. She continued to her plight in education to become a first. And they moved to Jackson, Mississippi, where her class was the first to become student teachers in the state of, in the city of Jackson, Mississippi, because of the liberal education and their character being known for being diverse and civilly engaged. They were the first students to become student teachers in the city of Jackson, Mississippi. They weren't voting yet. They were still talking and having the understanding that they wanted to make a difference, but they had to make a difference in their own sphere of influence until time would bring about a change. Well, my mother had the opportunity to move to California with my father, who was in the Marine Corps. They moved to Oceanside, California, where my mother became the first African-American teacher to sign a contract in the city of Oceanside in 1957. It was there where her superintendent said to her, "What are you going to do when your students call you the N-word?" She said, "I won't answer because that's not who I am." She continued to teach at Laurel Street School in Oceanside, California, and then moved on to San Diego, where my sister and I then entered public school back in a little while ago. I didn't really want you to get the year right. You might figure out how old I am. But we entered schools here in San Diego, and she taught us the value of activism, of education, of collective activism, and unity over a cause to make the plight better for those who lived in Southeast San Diego where we grew up. So as we grew up, we continued to use our voice. And as I grew up as an educator in my mother's footsteps, I had the opportunity to open 3 new schools in San Diego, to create equitable schools, and to train educators to become culturally proficient so that they could make the transformation. As a teacher, I would give my seniors at Lincoln High School on their 18th birthday a voter registration form as their gift to let their voice be heard and be known, that they must stand up, that they must make a difference, that they must not be silent where there is injustice still in our nation. I gave my students the opportunity to become civically engaged, which was a theme at the last school that I opened, E3 Civic High. And Michelle, you're out there, you visited us before. E3 Civic High, because our scholars of color have an obligation to unite with all allies for justice and equality for all citizens. And it's our job as educators to build that capacity for this next generation. Yes, I walk the beats. I walk the plank. I give money. We donate. We sponsor campaigns because we must have our voices heard. We must stay in the work. And as I'm here today with you, and an opportunity for you and your new leadership and your new year and this new era that we find ourselves in, I challenge you to continue to make your goals clear, to unite together over a cause, because a house divided against itself cannot stand. And I'm so excited to celebrate Black History Month, because we've always been there in the fabric of making our nation great. We'll always be there. And it's a joy to honor and to unite together with allies who are doing the same. So I want to thank you for having me tonight and allowing me to share my just a portion of my story in terms of the Black family and the contributions that we have made. And we're no different. We're not unique. All families have made the same unique contributions. And so thank you for having me tonight to share that.
Thank you so much. Thank you for making it with us. I know how busy you are. I'm really grateful. And I see some nodding heads and smiles and applause amongst our members. And I offer the same invitation to you that I offered to Carol earlier. Hopefully we will see you more frequently at our meetings, and I invite and encourage you to become a member.
Absolutely. Fun fact, when I was a principal at E3, or the executive director, I worked with a member from the Women's Democratic Club to start a voter registration drive at the high school. And so they would come on our campus and of course get all of our scholars registered, to make sure that they were not only registered, but they were educated on the issues, to understand how to read issues and how to make their voice heard. So we're looking forward to continuing our partnership. And yes, I would love to become a member. I'm gonna have to make sure I get those two meetings in my 45 days so that I can vote when it's time to come and make those endorsements. But yes, I would love to like I said, lock arms with you and be in partnership so that we can continue to make transformation.
Thank you so much. All right. I didn't want to save our guest speakers until after all the business was done, because I thought we could use a moment just to reflect on some things and remember why we're all here. So we took care of the bylaws, and I do want to say thank you to everyone who helped us to get to this point in our meeting. I know the bylaws can be a contentious topic, and I know that there were a lot of people who put in a lot of hours of hard work to get them to the point of delivery earlier in the meeting. The next thing on our agenda is the election of officers, and we have so we've got VP of Internal Relations, VP of External Relations, and also the Director of Communications and Direct Membership?
It was the Director of Membership and the External VP and the Internal VP.
So, Rosamond, can you get your nominating report?
Can I just make a quick comment? We can take nominations for the floor for the Director of Communications, even though we don't have anybody who applied.
We could actually take directions for nominations from the floor for everything.
Right.
So Rosamond, can you give your nominating report, and then we'll go into the any nominations from the floor or anything else?
Okay. The nominating committee comprised of three individuals: Sam Hurst, myself, Rosamond Blevins, and Cheryl Robertson. What we did was we asked anyone, we put this out to everyone. It went out in the it's on the website and went out in the last meetings, the applications. What we did have is, which I was extremely pleased about, is that we had two individuals and myself. The two individuals are for internal VP would be Sarah Davis, external VP, which would be Lori Sardina, and both of them are here today, and I would like each one of them to speak maybe for one moment to tell about why they are running for office. Could I do that? Let's go with Lori first.
Okay, well, thank you. I did submit an application and a resume, but it was late. And so I don't know if there's any way to share that with members. I do want to represent the club and help to build membership and encourage more participation in civic activities. I was very inspired by Dr. Griffith's story. I'm a teacher. I just retired last year, and I worked in some of the areas that are the lowest income students in the community college district. And one of our goals was to bridge the digital divide. We had students in my college classes that came from Lincoln High School, Morse High School, because many of those families didn't have access to computers, and I taught information technology. And I think that when I served in the state legislature, I realized we had to continue to do that at a statewide level. And for women in particular, if you don't have good computer skills, it's very, very difficult to compete in any kind of a career advancement in today's world. And let alone, it was that way before we all had to confront working from home and what we're facing now. The other thing I'd like to say that I've been working on is with the Standing Up for Racial Justice Coalition, we have a very serious problem with deaths in custody in San Diego County jails. And one case in particular last year was Elsa Serna. She died unattended. She was pregnant. And as a former chair of the Legislative Women's Caucus, one of the things that we worked on was to have equitable care for all women, but especially pregnant women in prisons and other jails and incarceration. And so the fact that here in San Diego County, we had that happen this recently, I've started doing some research on what we can do to improve those outcomes and save lives in custody for everyone here in San Diego County. And I think that would be very powerful to get this club active, working in coalition with these other groups that are working on that. So I would love to represent the club to build coalitions with other organizations. I really think that this club has great opportunity to advance, recruit new members, and promote some really good policies on equity, social equity, as well as reproductive justice, and other issues that the club has been working on for the last few years. Thank you for considering me for external vice president.
Lori, thank you very much. And I'm gonna share, as I get Sarah up here, I'm gonna share your application. Sarah, are you there? Let's see.
I am here, yes.
Thank you.
Let's see. Thank you. Good evening. I am excited to put myself forward for internal vice president. So I ran for California State Assembly in the 78th district last cycle and had the opportunity to get to know quite a few Democratic clubs here in San Diego County, including this one. And I will say that there was something that I loved and something that I hated about every single club. And I wanted to kind of pull that feedback in and pick a club to get much more involved in. And this is the one that I found myself most drawn to, because I believe that the very like broad draw of a Democratic Women's Club is a really great place to bring in people who have not already been involved. And I was particularly drawn to the internal vice president role, because I want to work on really engaging the members, particularly members who may have not participated much or may not have any idea what to do in between cycles, or are interested when we're off cycle but don't want to have anything to do with the actual election part because it gets very dramatic. So I want to kind of just get to know everyone, meet them where they're at, and see how we can build the club. I think that San Diego County, having recently flipped blue, being so geographically large, gives us a great opportunity to bring women in all over the county. And I look forward to the opportunity to do that.
Thank you, Sarah. And the last position that we were doing was the director of membership. And I've been doing the director of membership position now for the last 3 years, as well as being the treasurer. So I decided that I would continue on doing it. One of the things that I like to say, and this is kind of a strange one, everybody asked me about my name, which is Rosamund, and it's pronounced many different ways, and I've heard it many different ways, but it's still Rosamund. And I once asked my mom, why did you name me Rosamund? And she said, because I couldn't think of another name. I said, where did it come from? Well, Macbeth, and then Jane Eyre. So over 4 years ago when the man got elected, that's when I became involved in doing lots of volunteer work. And I looked at several clubs, and I live in La Mesa. And so I looked at the La Mesa Democratic Club, but then I was so drawn to this club because I thought it was promoting women, is dedicated by women, it was run by women, and I thought this is where I belong and this is where I've stayed. And I've learned so much in the last 4 years, and I'm just very proud to be a member of this club and a member of the e-board. Thank you. I think we should go on, and Luana, do you want to go ahead and see if there's anyone that would also like to apply for the position or be nominated for any of the positions? The last position that we don't have an application for or a volunteer for is Director of Communications.
This is Sarah.
Rosamond, can you go ahead?
Oh, I was hoping to make a nomination. Are you only accepting self-nominations, or can I nominate someone else?
I think this is the part where we're opening up to nominations from the floor. I just wanted to get Rosamond's full report, and of course we're opening the nominations for any of the roles.
And Luana, can I make a quick comment that the internal VP and the director of membership, based on the new bylaws, are running for a 2-year term, and the external VP and the director of communications will be a 1-year term to get them in cycle.
Okay. Hopefully that, you know, maybe that'll influence the willingness to serve in some of the roles. So Sarah, you said you wanted to nominate someone for something?
Yes, I'd love to nominate Jen French for the Director of Communications.
Jen, do you accept the nomination?
Wow, I'm super flattered. Yes, I will just disclose that I'm new to the club, so I was nervous about how to jump in, but I'm just quick intro. Well, I don't know what the procedure is, but yes, I am very flattered and I am humbled and I would love to accept.
So I will second that nomination then, because I got to work with Jen on the nominating committee and I think she would be awesome.
All right. Jen, just especially since you're new to the club, can you just say a few words to our members they can have before we move with the rest of the process?
Yes, thank you. So my name is Jen French. I am an attorney here in San Diego. I practice plaintiff side class action for employees, consumer and privacy class action. So I sue companies that hurt people. I'm very passionate about increasing the status of law in society. And that informs all of my decisions, including the pro bono work that I do and the other organizations that I serve. I am on the board of the Coalition for Reproductive Justice in San Diego and also the Board of California Women Lawyers. And I communicate for a living, although I am not being extremely articulate right now. And I also have a large Instagram following. And so I do think that I have some skills that can hopefully contribute to this organization. I am a new member, but it was a home for me, like similar to what Sarah said about how she found that this was the organization for her. So thank you again for considering me. I'm very, very honored to be among such amazing folks.
Do we have any other, thank you, Jen. Do we have any other nominations from the floor? All right, looks like we're done. So point of clarification, we do this one roll at a time, or do we just move to, do we entertain a motion for the whole?
Excuse me, Luana, Dave Myers is, we have a hand.
Oh, Dave, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
That's okay. I was just going to, actually, it's in line with what you were talking about. I would just make a motion that we adopt all four as proposed by acclamation.
All right. Is there a second?
I second that.
All right. Case. Oh, never mind. Doug put his hand down. Right, so there's a.
I was going to second, so sorry.
Oh, okay. So there's a motion and a second. Any discussion? No? Okay. All in favor? I guess we can just unmute and say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Are there any opposed?
There better not be.
Well, thank you. And I'm looking forward to working with everyone. And I want to thank, Rebecca Fildes Miller and Rolla for their service to the club. And, you know, as one of the new e-board members, I hope we all do you the work that you've all done before justice. Okay.
So I need to raise my hand.
Ma'am?
So because the new bylaws were adopted tonight, I would like to make a motion to bring all of our officers, our new e-board officers in line, their terms in line with the bylaws. I would like to move that we extend our president and our secretary, that was Luana and Kathy that we elected last month, extend their terms from 1 year to 2 years. So again, it aligns with the new bylaws.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Anyone who is having trouble raising their hand or voting, please. Okay, has everyone voted who wants to vote? Okay, still seeing the vote number go up. I see you, Yvonne, and
great.
I see Sarah.
Rosman, are you voting? Did you vote?
Okay. So that's three. All right. So let me look. Dave, is it one or two?
Dave and Dahmer, yes, thank you.
All right, thank you. So that was 26, 27. So everyone lower your hands, please. All opposed, please raise your hand. Michelle, I see your
hand. No, I'm trying to lower it. I'm trying to lower it.
Okay. All right, it's down now.
Thank you.
All right, has everyone voted who wants to vote? All right, well, it looks like you guys are gonna be stuck with me and Kathy for 2 years instead of one. All right, we made it through the election of officers. Now it's time, thank you all, let's see here. It's time for officer reports. And I'll wait till last. So, Kathy, do you have a report?
I don't really have a report, but I did want to comment on how great a couple of our new electeds are doing. I'm so pleased to see Nora Vargas just hit the ground running with the Board of Supervisors, and I feel so much more hopeful with her there now with Nathan. So I wanted to give her a shout out. And also to our fabulous new Congresswoman in California 53, which is my district. Sarah jumped in with both feet to lead, and I'm so, so proud of her. So that's my report.
Okay, let's see. Now our outgoing officers, do either of you, Ramla or Dr. Rebecca, have reports that you'd like to give this evening?
No, I
Esther's here.
Esther has
a report.
Give us Esther.
I'm so excited for all of you. You guys are going to do such a great job, and I am looking forward to coming just watching her and not the rest of you. Esther, can you say goodnight?
Good night.
And then let's see here. Rosamond, do you have a report?
Yes, I have a report. Okay. We had, since we went into Zoom meetings, our membership had dropped to right under 150. But I'm happy to report now that we have 171 members. So we've gained members. We did drop for a while and it came up. So thank you so much for the new members that have come in. If this is your first meeting, thank you so much. As for our finances, we have exactly $2,973.76 in it. We've had two expenditures. One was for the Zoom meeting setup that we did, and $50 went to our Secretary of State for our membership. Since we do have a small balance in it, I think maybe it's not appropriate at this meeting, or maybe it is at this meeting. I would like to make a motion that we donate $499 or $500 to the Food Bank of San Diego. It's in desperate need right now, and it would be a good thing for our club to do, especially since our membership.
Did I hear a second?
I just seconded it. I seconded.
Okay, second. We've got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion about the motion? I guess we can vote by acclamation because there doesn't seem to be any discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right. I love cricket sometimes. the motion passes. Rosamond, did you have anything else?
No, the only thing I have to say is that I'm looking forward to working with the new e-board and with our past e-board members. I think we'll make a great team. Hopefully that we can all come together and one of these days meet in person and give each other a hug. That's
because I hear you've got the best kitchen.
I'm a pretty good cook. So yes, I'm looking forward to that day. So thank you. And thank you, members, for your dedication, for your membership, because with our membership dues that we bring in, we're able to do so many things. And again, thank you.
Okay. So is there anyone else that needs to give a report? Well, I guess it's me now. I had one idea about what I was going to talk about, and then today happened. First, you know, what I was going to talk about is the things that I'm kind of looking forward to doing with and for the club. Some of you know that my area of expertise is organizational development. So one of the things that I'm looking forward to doing in the coming months is convening some strategic planning effort in order to get input from members in terms of direction and vision, identify where we need to perhaps have some committees and working groups. One of the things that I'm passionate about, as I'm sure you all know, is education. And specifically, I've been doing volunteer work in support of education for women and girls for a really long time. And I'd like to help with encouraging young women to become more civically engaged and helping to support civic education that I think as people understand what it is that they're asked to do and what that looks like, I think that it'll make it easier for them to make the decision to do that. Now, when I said I had what I was going to talk about and then today happened, we talked about Black history. We had a couple of Black History Month presentations. And we've all been looking at what's been happening in the news in the last year. And the call and the reason for all of us to work together really came home today. I don't know how many of you know this, but I have a son. And my son is 6'4", very dark complexion, very, you know, solidly built young man. And when he stands up, he doesn't have to say anything. He's just scary. And his instructions that I've given him is that if he ever has any police contact, he's supposed to communicate with them politely that he needs to call his mother to let her know what's going on. And so my son's almost 30 years old, but I got a phone call. I got that call from him today. And, you know, we talked a little bit. I got an understanding of where he was and kind of what was going on. He called me back. He said everything was okay. I was relieved, and that was wonderful. And then he called me back like 15 minutes later. He got stopped in on Home Avenue at the gas station. They actually pulled him over as he was pumping his gas. I guess they called that a traffic stop. And then right after that, he drove to Balboa Park. He was gonna go for a walk at the park with the young lady that was with him. And he was sitting in his car parked, and he got involved. He had another traffic stop, you know, and each time his car was stopped. And so I don't say this because I want everybody to feel bad, but just that I want you to understand the urgency of the moment and how sometimes we think, you know, well, what were they doing? And well, you know, maybe they shouldn't have, you know, breathed as hard as they were breathing. And, you know, my son is okay. He was able to call me back and tell me what happened, but stuff is happening every day. And as a mother, it's not good for my health, because what I feel every time I get one of those phone calls from him, there are no words for it. And I don't want any mother to have that feeling. And so we all have to work together to make the world a better place. And I cannot be effective or authentic or genuine as a leader of this club if I do not address intersectionality. And so my hope is for all of us to think about how our identities impact not only ourselves and how we walk around every day, but impact the way we perceive and interact with the people around us and what we can do to change that. Some of you have been in meetings where you see me stop my video and you see a little boy. That little boy is my grandson. And my fervent wish is that when my grandson is almost 30 years old, we won't be having conversations like this. So we've had our meeting. I've given my report. So my report is that's what I'm committed to. And I hope some of you will join me in that fight. Do we have any old business that we need to address that we haven't already taken care of? Do we have any new business that we need to bring up?
Yes, please.
All right.
So in line with what Dr. Richmond is talking about, this is Dave and Dominic. I'm going to place another article in the chat, and it's in line with what Lori Saldana had briefly talked about. Here in San Diego County, we have the highest rate of inmate mortality of any jail in the state of California. 80% of those who have died in custody were never criminally convicted. And 80% of them come from communities of color. So as Dr. Richmond has pointed out, there are lots of mothers out there who didn't know that their son or daughter was going to end up in jail that day and did not come out alive. So what I would ask this club to do for future references is really think about passing a resolution demanding that our state legislators conduct an independent audit similar to what they did on the hepatitis issue of the county jail system. The County Law Enforcement Review Board has recently announced that they are going to conduct a subcommittee review of the jails. They have almost zero power to investigate, subpoena, and create a report to do such an activity. Plus, they don't have the funding to do it. And as we've seen recently, the CLRB board not only cleared a jail nurse and a jail deputy who watched the person Lori mentioned seize in the cell, hit her head, and then they closed the door and she was dead 2 days later. And then the CLRB changed its mind. So we need an independent statewide audit. And I would hope for future club business is to pass a resolution demanding our state legislators act to conduct an independent audit of the jails in San Diego County. Thank you.
All right. Lori, I see your hand. Was that related to Dave's item or was it something different?
It's related to what Dave was just discussing. I've been doing some more research on the Legislative Women's Caucus work on women in incarceration. And, you know, unfortunately, when we started transferring people out of prison, state prisons, into county jails, we lost a lot of resources to manage people's well-being, including pregnant women. They used to all go to one facility where they had maternal care and medical care for any inmate who was expecting. And now that they've been transferred to jail, because the young woman who died was not only recovering from drug issues, but she was pregnant. And I think that a resolution or frankly, just a request to the Legislative Women's Caucus in Sacramento, asking for them to submit an audit request would be a very powerful way to look at this. And not just look at women, but I think we need to look, of course, at all inmates who are dying or being disabled and compare San Diego to other counties. Because as Dave mentioned, the county or the Citizens Law Enforcement Review Board, they've formed a subcommittee to try and do this, but they're acknowledging they don't have the expertise, they don't have the skill set, it could take them a while. Whereas the state is very skilled in doing this type of an assessment and looking in depth at best practices. So I'd be happy to work with Dave and others to come up with a good letter to submit to the Legislative Women's Caucus asking for them to request that an audit be carried out.
So I have Lori, I have Dave. Do I have any other volunteers that would want to move forward working together to develop a resolution that we could then vote on as a member, as a body?
I'd be happy to start with them.
All right, I've got Yvonne, was that you?
I would love to help with that.
We've got Yvonne, Susan, is there someone else? I think we've got a good number. We've got four people right now.
Hi, this is Jen French. I'm happy to help, but if you have enough people, I am more than happy to allow those people to do the good work.
Jen, actually, because it is, I think that it would be kind of in your wheelhouse. I would appreciate your help with that.
Sure, of course. Happy to help.
All right.
The one I had my name out also, but I was on mute.
Okay, Michelle. All right. So, Michelle, was that related to this or did you want something else?
No, this.
Okay, perfect. So I wrote your name down too. So how much time do you think you all would need to come up with something and come back? Do you think you could have it by the next meeting?
Yes.
I think okay. So.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Is there any other discussion of this or any questions or anything anybody needs? All right. So thank you, Dave, for bringing that up. I think it's a great idea. Is there any other new business? All right, hearing none, we will move on to announcements. You know, it's 8:14. Maybe we can be done by 8:30. If you have announcements, if you could raise your hand and I'll call on you. Or if we don't have any announcements, I could just find some music to play. For Kate Bishop.
Sorry, you don't get music that soon. Sorry, Luana. I just wanted to, hi, Kate Bishop, she, her, hers.
I'm delighted to announce that I've been elected president of the new San Diego Democratic Education Alliance. Super excited about this new club, and I wanted to invite all of you to come check it out. We meet the final Sunday of the month at 2 p.m., and our mission is to get educators, parents, and education advocates involved in the Democratic Party so that we can push education issues onto platforms and we can get really good school board members all over our county. And we know that you all very much value education. So we would love to have your voices there. Please join us. I was gonna put the link in the chat, but I'm on my phone, so I can't. So look us up on Facebook at San Diego Democratic Education Alliance, or you can email me at kate@katebishop.vote if you have any further questions. And I wanna say that our next meeting on the 28th at 2 p.m. will feature Luana Richmond doing a presentation on Black educators. And we're really excited about that presentation. So thank you so much, Luana, for doing that.
And now we know why I'm always losing my voice. So thank you, Kate. Samantha Jenkins.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Thank you for recognizing me. I would just like to share with everyone that the Citizens Advisory Board on Police and Community Relations, mind you, this is not the new commission, but this is an existing board, currently has vacancies for district representatives for District 1, 2, and 8. And we are really looking for some progressive community-minded people to apply for these positions. If you need any more information, this particular board does, feel free to contact me. I can put my email address in the chat. And other than that, even if you're not interested in applying for a specific seat on the board, we need to increase our community engagement. And so I'm asking for more people to attend our meetings from the general community. We generally have our meetings via Zoom on the fourth Monday of every month. And that's usually at 6 p.m. So again, we're looking for people to fill District 1, 2, and 8 seats. We're also looking for someone with a background in human resources to fill an at-large type seat, and someone with a role in the probations department. We're looking for diverse people, as I said, and we really need some progressive-minded folks who are interested in serving the community around issues of policing. So I'll put my information in the chat. Please consider it. And if you're not interested in a seat, please join us for meetings. Thank you.
All right, Lori Saldana.
Very quickly, if you're not aware, FEMA is now paying for emergency hotel rooms for unsheltered people and medically fragile people during the COVID pandemic, but City of San Diego is not providing them and the County of San Diego is not providing them. So I wanted to encourage people, if you are willing to call your city council member and county supervisor and let them know they need to provide these hotel rooms that the federal government is willing to pay for. We have a lot of people that are homeless. They are being criminalized, their belongings are being taken away from them, and they don't want to go into the convention center out of safety concerns. And also called Todd Gloria's office. So homelessness is another issue that I hope this club will be committed to do some work on. And a very important thing right now is to encourage your elected official to use those federal funds and provide these hotel rooms to people in need.
Thank you, Lori. All right, any other hands? All right, Wendy. You have to unmute.
Unmute, hi, sorry. I just want to ask Lori if the city officials can mandate that hotels give rooms up. Do they have, like, what would they do? What's their influence?
Right. The city has more to do with the convention center is being operated by the city of San Diego. They are providing that instead of hotel rooms. So that's where the city comes in. And the reason they are doing that is that they can then request funds to cover the operational expenses and overhead of the convention center. But it's not the safest place for a lot of people. So they need to hear that the convention center is not a good alternative when the federal government is willing to pay for hotel rooms. And I see Shane has her hand up. Shane and I did a lot of work on this in last year to put pressure on local officials to open up these hotel rooms even before the FEMA funds were available. I don't know if Shane wants to add to that, but it's a combination of county and city that needs to hear these requests.
Thank you.
And is it okay to continue, Luana?
Yes, Shane.
So to tag on to what Lori was saying, and it doesn't just actually have to be the city of San Diego. I took a screenshot, I posted on my Facebook earlier this week of the actual announcement, the proclamation or whatever that came out from FEMA. Previously, it was 75% reimbursable from FEMA, and then the state of California was picking up 25%. And now they're 100% reimbursable through FEMA. And it says it's like localities, like local government. So it doesn't have to just be through the county. Any city anywhere can do these hotels. So Chula Vista, Oceanside, alcohol, like, you know, it's not just the city of San Diego. Mm-hmm. And absolutely, like we were pushing last year to get the occupancy up to the 90%. The last time I checked last week, it was up to like 96 or 97%. So like we, you know, yay, but also they reduced the number of rooms that were secured. So the math looks better. So when the pandemic first hit, we had like 2,000 rooms secured with the same type of funding to pay for it, and nobody was in them. And now here we are in a much worse place, and we only have less than 700 rooms secured, and it's 100% reimbursable. And we have all these nonprofits who are more than willing to provide the wraparound services at the hotel because they're already doing it anyway, but just out on the street. Anyway, just as a heads up, there is still a lot of work we could do there, and it's literally paid for. Somebody just needs to freaking do it.
So my question to Lori or Shane, is there any specific action we can take as a club to help support this? Because I'm hearing about the problem, I'm not hearing a proposed specific remedy that we can act upon.
So I would say, I mean, and I, you know, I'm busy for the next month. I'm running for office. Like, I'll just be honest. Like, and it sucks because one of the reasons why I'm running is this kind of crap. So basically when I saw the proposal that came out that said, hey, these hotel rooms are 100% reimbursable, I'd gotten a call from a city council person, I won't say who, not from San Diego, it was a different city council person, called me and said, hey, what was the deal with those hotel rooms again? I got this homeless mom in my city with her three kids. She can't afford her hotel room anymore. And I was like, does she have diabetes or bad asthma? He's like, yeah, she's got diabetes. I'm like, she literally qualifies for one of these rooms. And she's been paying for a hotel room out of her own pocket this whole time when she could have had a FEMA reimbursed room. So this is a issue that absolutely affects women and children and everybody, like everybody. It's not, you know, gender doesn't really matter on this issue. So I don't have the bandwidth to lead on this, maybe Lori does, but literally just the education piece was the most time-consuming part back in November when we first started doing this, was explaining to people, no, wraparound services as defined by FEMA is not mental health or social services. It literally says those are called support services. Wraparound services as defined by FEMA are laundry, security, and cleaning. That's it. You can't put people in a place that doesn't have access to laundry, security, or cleaning. Any hotel has access to those things. And they don't all have to be centrally located in a Mission Valley. They're just, I think there was too much going on. And as usual, the powerless people just sort of got forgotten and weren't prioritized in the COVID response. So, and so here we are a year later.
So Shane, I don't mean to cut you off. Thank you, Lori.
I think cut me off.
So Michelle has her hand off. Shane, I'm trying to make sure we give everybody a chance to speak.
Yeah, cut me off. I need to be cut off. Sorry.
All right. And so the specific question was about action. Right. I hear Lori saying "I propose," which are words that usually follow up with some type of remedy or solution.
I propose, I will develop a fact sheet that can be sent to members and a list of the contacts to be called. And so I propose that members contact their elected officials and make sure that they are aware of these FEMA funds and that they start asking why they're not being used throughout San Diego County. And so if we have members throughout the county, great. They can call their city council, their county supervisor, their mayors, their congressional representatives. So I'll work on a fact sheet that we can get out to members that will support those phone calls.
Okay, so are members fine with this being distributed to them between meetings so we don't have to wait till March?
Yep.
Perfect. Okay, Michelle.
Just a quick word on redistricting. I know the census final numbers are not out yet, but there are some, the state, 14 people on the state redistricting commission are holding meetings. I don't know if the county is. I haven't really had a chance to really check all of those, but you guys check them. The school board, every single district is going to be redistricted. City council, San Diego City Council, and any other city that actually has sub-districts. So we need to have our voice heard as to what is going to make a difference in our communities, because that makes a big difference going forward for the next 10 years. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Michelle, and thank you for that reminder. Any other announcements? Ruth, I see your hand. I'm so sorry. The hand blended into your cabinets.
Okay. Well, this is not exactly pertinent to the club, but I wanted to tell everyone, I fly a flag 24/7 lit properly, and it was stolen. I reported it to the police on February 6th. And then this past weekend on CBS News, they reported that there were a couple of flags stolen.
Wow.
And so I think it might be something, you know, to be aware of. And that's all. And I will be having a flag flying very soon.
Okay. I appreciate that. Any other announcements? Okay, so for the month of February, Gary Gardner.
Hello there. I joined late. Hi, congratulations. So good to see you with your world behind you. You always have the coolest backdrops. Some others were on, and maybe somebody mentioned it earlier, but some of us were on the recall of Dr. Jen Campbell meeting that took place at the same time as the club meeting. And so the recall is underway, and tomorrow will be the last day for Jen Campbell to respond to the written notice that she was given. And then the recall will begin. And so they're having a kickoff caravan on Saturday, February 27th, signature gathering caravan. So just wanted to report that.
All right, thank you. You and no one else had told us before you did. So thank you for making sure we're in the know.
Okay.
All right. Any other announcements? Are we sure? I'm looking for hands. Okay, I'm gonna share my screen because I don't know how to share the sound without sharing my screen. And so here we go. I guess you guys will get to hear the first song that I picked, and hopefully it doesn't like tank.
Girls, we run this mother. Girls, we run this mother. Girls, who run the world? Girls, who run the world? Girls, who run the world? Girls, who run this mother?
So the meeting is adjourned, and if anybody has any questions, I am all-